Morte D'Arthur by Tennyson. So all day long the noise of battle rolled among the mountains by the winter sea, until King Arthur's table, man by man, had fallen in lioness about their lord, King Arthur. Then, because his wound was deep, the bold Sir Bedivere uplifted him, Sir Bedivere the last of all his knights, and bore him to a chapel nigh the field, a broken chancel with a broken cross, that stood on a dark strait of barren land. On one side lay the ocean, and on one lay a great water, and the moon was full. Then spake King Arthur to Sir Bedivere, "The sequel of today unsoldiers all the goodliest fellowship of famous knights whereof this world holds record. Such a sleep they sleep, the men I loved. I think that we shall never more, at any future time, delight our souls with talk of knightly deeds, walking about the gardens and the halls of Camelot as in the days that were. I perish by this people which I made, though Merlin swear that I should come again to rule once more, but let what will be, be. I am so deeply smitten through the helm that without help I cannot last till morn. Thou therefore take my brand Excalibur, which was my pride, for thou rememberest how, in those old days, one summer noon an arm rose up from out the bosom of the lake, clothed in white samite, mystic, wonderful, holding the sword, and how I rode across and took it, and have worn it like a king, and wheresoever I am sung or told in after time, this also shall be known. But now delay not. Take Excalibur and fling him far into the middle mere. Watch what thou seest, and lightly bring me word." To him replied the bold Sir Bedivere, "It is not meet, O king, to lead thee thus, Idylls alone and smitten through the helm. A little thing may harm a wounded man. Yet I thy hest will all perform at full. Watch what I see, and lightly bring thee word." So saying, from the ruined shrine he stepped, and in the moon athwart the place of tombs, where lay the mighty bones of ancient men, old knights, and over them the sea wind sang, shrill, chill with flakes of foam. He stepping down by zigzag paths and juts of pointed rock, came on the shining levels of the lake. There drew he forth the brand Excalibur, and over him, drawing it the winter moon, brightening the skirts of a long cloud, ran forth, and sparkled keen with frost against the hilt. For all the haft twinkled with diamond sparks, myriads of topaz lights and jacinth work of subtlest jewelry. He gazed so long that both his eyes were dazzled as he stood, this way and that, dividing the swift mind in act to throw. But at last it seemed better to leave Excalibur concealed there in the many knotted water flags that whistled stiff and dry about the marge. So strode he back slow to the wounded king. Then spake Sir Arthur to Sir Bedivere, "Hast thou performed my mission which I gave? What is it thou hast seen, or what hast heard?" And answer made the bold Sir Bedivere, "I heard the ripple washing in the reeds, and the wild water lapping on the crag." To whom replied King Arthur, faint and pale, "Thou hast betrayed thy nature and thy name, not rendering true answer, as beseemed thy fealty, nor like a noble knight, for sure a sign had followed either hand or voice or else a motion of the mere. This is a shameful thing for men to lie. Yet now I charge thee, quickly go again, as thou art lief and dear, and do the thing I bade thee. Watch, and lightly bring me word." Then went Sir Bedivere the second time across the ridge and paced beside the mere, counting the dewy pebbles, fixed in thought. But when he saw the wonder of the hilt, how curiously and strangely chased, he smote his palms together, and he cried aloud, "And if indeed I cast the brand away, surely a precious thing, one worthy note, should thus be lost for ever from the earth, which might have pleased the eyes of many men. What good should follow this if this were done? What harm undone? Deep harm to disobey, seeing obedience is the bond of rule. Were it well to obey then, if a king demand an act unprofitable against himself? The king is sick and knows not what he does. What record or what relic of my lord should be to after time but empty breath and rumours of a doubt? But were this kept, stored in some treasure house of mighty kings, someone might show it at a joust of arms, saying King Arthur's sword Excalibur, wrought by the lonely maiden of the lake, 9 years she wrought it, sitting in the deeps upon the hidden bases of the hills. So might some old man speak in the aftertime to tell the people, winning reverence, but now much honour and much fame were lost. So spake he, clouded with his own conceit, and hid Excalibur the second time, and so strode back slow to the wounded king. Then spoke King Arthur, breathing heavily, "What is it thou hast seen, or what hast heard?" And answer made the bold Sir Bedivere, "I heard the water lapping on the crag, and the long ripple washing in the reeds." To whom replied King Arthur, much in wrath, "Ah, miserable and unkind, untrue, unknightly, traitor-hearted, woe is me! Authority forgets a dying king, laid widowed of the power in his eye that bowed the will. I see thee what thou art, for thou, the latest left of all my knights, in whom should meet the officers of all, thou wouldst betray me for the precious hilt, either from lust or gold, or like a girl valuing the giddy pleasures of the eyes. Yet for a man may fail in duty twice, and the third time may prosper, get thee hence. But if thou spare to fling Excalibur, I will arise and slay thee with my hands." Then quickly rose Sir Bedivere and ran, and leaping down the ridges lightly plunged among the bulrush beds and clutched the sword, and strongly wheeled and threw it. The great brand made lightnings in the splendour of the moon, and flashing round and round and whirled an arch, shot like a streamer of the northern morn, seen where the moving isles of winter shock by night with noises of the northern sea. So flashed and fell the brand Excalibur, but ere he dipped the surface, rose an arm, clothed in white samite, mystic, wonderful, and caught him by the hilt and brandished him 3 times, and drew him under in the mere. And lightly went the other to the king. Then spoke King Arthur, drawing thicker breath, "Now see I by thine eyes that this is done. Speak out, what is it thou hast heard or seen?" And answer made the bold Sir Bedivere, "Sir King, I close mine eyes, lest the gems should blind my purpose, for I never saw, nor shall see, here or anywhere, till I die, not though I live 3 lives of mortal men, so great a miracle as yonder hilt." Then with both hands I flung him, wheeling him, but when I looked again, behold, an arm, clothed in white samite, mystic wonderful, that caught him by the hilt and brandished him 3 times, and drew him under in the mere. And answer made King Arthur, breathing hard, "My end draws nigh, 'tis time that I were gone. Make broad thy shoulders to receive my weight. Bear me to the margin, yet I fear my wound hath taken cold and I shall die." So saying, from the pavement he half rose, slowly with pain, reclining on his arm, and looking wistfully with wide blue eyes as in a picture. Him Sir Bedivere remorsely regarded through his tears, and would have spoken, but he found not words, then took with care, and kneeling on one knee, o'er both his shoulders drew the languid hands, and rising bore him through the place of tombs. But as he walked, King Arthur panted hard, like one that feels a nightmare on his bed, when all the house is mute. So sighed the king, muttering and murmuring in his ear, "Quick, quick, I fear it is too late and I shall die." But the other swiftly strode from ridge to ridge, clothed with his breath, and looking as he walked, larger than human on the frozen hills. He heard the deep behind him and a cry before. His own thought drove him like a goad. Dry clashed his harness in the icy caves and barren chasms, and all to the left and right the bare black cliff clanged round him as he based, his feet on juts of slippery crag that rang, sharp smitten with the dint of armoured heels. And on a sudden, lo, the level lake, and the long glories of the winter moon.